بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وآله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره اللهم أخرجني من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمني بنور الفهم اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance and assistance and thank Him for the blessing of being able to meet again and learn more about Islamic belief system. As you remember, as the second argument for existence of God, we talked about the argument which is based on the innate knowledge and desire that every human being has for God, Burhanul Fitrah. And this argument is well known to Muslims and also to some other faith communities like Christians. So in the book you find reference also to some articulation of the argument by some Christian thinkers. One of the things that we have to discuss after clarifying the meaning of fitrah and what are the characteristics of those things which are fitri is that in human beings we have self-love, what we call hubbul dhat. Inshallah, if we get chance, we talk more about it in akhlaq. But here, because it has been mentioned in the book, so I just quickly refer to this. Every human being, and you can even argue that to some extent, maybe even animals have this, but maybe not consciously. Every human being has love for himself or herself. And this is the main motive behind our activities. According to most of Muslim scholars, this is the only motive, and everything else goes back to this. Even those who do something to please God, they say they do it out of love for themselves because they want to get reward or they want to get closer to God. Or even those who give their life, they become martyrs, they say again it goes back to their love for themselves. Even the sacrifice that mothers undertake, they say goes back to hubbul dhat or self-love. Almost all, or at least you can say, great majority of our scholars have this idea. But there is another opinion, and that is what I believe, and that is self-love is very important motive in us, but it's not the only one. And we have independent love also for others, although in many people or most of people their love for others comes from their love for themselves and they help others because they want to get something for themselves. But I said this does not need to be the case. You can have genuine love for other people without thinking of gaining anything. Even you can have independent love for some good qualities like knowledge without thinking of what impact it would have on me. Or for example, love for beauty without thinking of what impact it's going to have on me. So this is a big discussion. I don't want to go into this. But what is in the book is based on the view of the majority of scholars that the main motive in human beings is self-love, and out of this we have few desires or few major motives. One is we want to be there forever. Yeah, every human being loves to be there as long as possible. If someone lives 100 years and you say you can live, you know, 101 years, say, yes, please. You know, if 1,000 years, you say, it's not enough. I want to be 1,001 years. So anything that you offer, they want something more. Because in human beings, there is desire for eternity. We don't want to finish. We don't want to cease to exist. Which is actually a good thing if it is understood well. And if it is put in the right direction, this is good. Because then this would be the motive to work for your eternal life. The mistake that most of people do is think they can achieve eternity in this life. It is not possible. So, we want to have eternal life. We want to have perfection. And there is no limit in perfection that we want. We want to have absolute perfection. In us, there is desire for moving towards absolute perfection. If you say you can be much better than what you are now, but there is a possibility of even more, say, yes, I want to be even better than what you are offering me. There is no way to be satisfied. And also, desire for happiness. There is in us desire for happiness. Which is not desire for a larger quantity of life, it's actually desire for a better quality of life. So self-love tells you, try to live longer and live better. And happiness, pleasure, is something about a better quality of life. In any case, what is important is that in every human being, we have these desires. Now we want to see how we can benefit from discussion for understanding existence of God. But before we move on to that point, which is the last point about this argument, there is a discussion about why some people have not developed a clear sense of fitrah. You know, there are people who are not religious. And all these things, you know, would not, you know, ring any bell, you know, in their mind. What is the reason why some people are not religious? Or maybe even they are against religion. Aren't they given the same fitrah that we are given? Yes, of course they are given, because we are all human beings and by nature we are the same. So why they are different? So there are a few points. One is, sometimes people have not been given proper presentation of faith. The way God is introduced to them, the way faith in general is introduced to them, has not been convincing them, has come with problems. And because they have not been able to understand the real God, they have not been able to find good answers for their questions. They said, let's leave aside totally the concept of God. This is something that happens to some people when they are not able to have good presentation of faith. The way some people present God, or some communities, or some, you know, religious traditions, you know, is mixed with problems. And people, because of those problems, they want to reject God. For example, sometimes, you know, religion gets mixed with superstitious ideas. And therefore people, as long as they are not well educated, can remain religious. When they go to a school and university and, you know, get degree and they see the world, they read, they study, those superstitious ideas would not be acceptable. So they may just leave aside the whole concept of religion. The other problem is that sometimes people also have desire for living without any restriction. And for some people, religion is restricting. You are losing your choices. You are losing part of your freedom. You have to lose some of the things that you really like to enjoy. So, as the Quran says, يُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ. Human beings have this tendency that they don't want anything to be in front of them and stopping them. They want to be 100% free. But a mistaken concept of freedom. Because, you know, if, for example, as a student, you want freedom, it means freedom to be able to study, freedom not to be annoyed by others, freedom of having equal access to good education, teacher, textbook, all this freedom. But if someone says freedom for a student is whenever he wants, he comes. Whenever he wants, he leaves the school. He can take exam. He can, you know, say, I don't want to take exam. I can, you know, play in the class. This is the freedom that I want as a student. This type of freedom is not real freedom. But unfortunately, many people want this type of freedom in their life. And for them, religion is a big problem. Because religion comes with a set of, you know, regulations. But we believe that if someone understands religion properly, actually religion is liberating. Religion brings freedom. You know, if you want to understand how free a religious person is, just consider a few examples. For example, a person who is addicted to smoking or to alcohol. And you, as a religious person, you are not addicted to anything. Isn't this a freedom? How much they suffer when they are addicted? Or there are lots of different types of addiction, lots of different types of corruption, bad habits. Religious people are very free. And this is why, you know, religious people can be the best students, the best scientists, the best scholars, the best business people, because they just focus on it. They don't have anything to stop them. But if you want to do lots of other mischief on the side of your study or business, then you cannot be successful. If we really understand religion, we would see that religion is liberating. As the Quran says, يَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. Rasulullah was removing the chains that had chained up people, freeing them. Now, sometimes I use this example. If you give people instructions about traffic regulations, you know, you can give them a whole book of manuals of driving. One way of looking at this, oh, so many rules, so many wajibat and haram, you know, about driving. But if you are patient and think about it, you realize actually with observing these regulations, we have the best chance of driving safely and quickly even. Because if no one observes these regulations, no one even can be able to reach home. So it's a matter of safety, and also even it can be faster. Although you are asked to reduce your speed, But if everyone reduces the speed, then we can at least move that speed that fast. But everyone wants to, for example, drive, you know, maximum speed, then you will have accident, you will have traffic, you know, you will not be able to reach. So Sharia is like traffic regulations. You observe these things so that life can be going smoothly without any problem. So some people don't want God or religion because they want to be free in a negative sense. Sometimes people also, unfortunately, have been influenced by empiricism. And that is the idea that the only acceptable truth is something that you can experience, or something that you can verify empirically, something that you can understand by your senses, something that you can touch or smell or taste or see or hear, something that you can take to laboratory, something that you can put under a microscope. These are the things that they accept. If there is anything beyond, they don't accept. This is a problem. You know, the famous sentence someone said, I cannot see God in my theater lecture when I'm doing surgery, or I'm not able to see God in my laboratory, so God does not exist. And our answer is, actually, if God was seen by you in your, you know, laboratory, that was not God. God that you can see is not going to be our God. God has to be infinite and unlimited. There is a famous person you must have heard, you know, Bertrand Russell. He is a well-known philosopher, and also he has books on history of philosophy, and philosophy and mathematics, different things. He says that the reason I stopped believing in God is that when I was young, one day I was riding bicycle, and this came to my mind that if everything is created by God, then who has created God? And I didn't have any answer, and no religion has answer for this. So I stopped believing in God. Again, you see, this is a lack of proper education about faith, about God, about theology. It looks very good question. If everything is created by God, so who has created God? But as you will explain later, we would not say everything is created by God. We say every contingent being is created. Not everything, not every being. Beings are one of the two. Some are contingent, some are dependent, some are caused. They need to be finally created by uncaused cause, by God. But there are some types of being that we can imagine. Of course, there's only one instance for that. But we can imagine as a universal concept, wajibul wujud, something that exists because of itself, by itself. So anyways, something very simple. He didn't find answer, and because their mind also was very much, you know, preoccupied by science, so he denied the existence of God. Anyway, these are just a few points why some people, despite having fitrah, may not believe in God. Okay, now let's see how we can develop an argument based on fitrah. There is something in the book which is very subtle. I hope, inshallah, when you read, you will find it understandable. Now I try to explain it as a, inshallah, help. Sometimes we are talking about a knowledge that people develop about God, which is not through concepts. We call it knowledge by presence. العلم الحضوري. Because you know, we have two types of knowledge. We have knowledge by presence, العلم الحضوري, and we have knowledge which comes through concepts. You can say conceptual knowledge. العلم الحصولي. Most of our knowledge is the second type. We know something when we have an image, a concept of that thing in our mind. Why you know philosophy, history, mathematics, physics, chemistry, and then you make lots of, you know, things out of these things? Because in your mind you have lots of concepts that correspond to the real world, and by working on those concepts you can understand the relations between the things outside. Even when I am looking at you, when I am talking to you, when I am listening to you, philosophers say it's all through mental images. We never have immediate understanding of each other. You know, you think you are looking at me directly, but indeed you are not looking at me directly. You have an image of me in your mind. And that's the first thing which is known to you. That is primarily known to you. And because that image is like a mirror that reflects me, then through that image, you think of me. And sometimes you make mistakes. You know, for example, you put a pen into water. Half of the pen into water. When you look at it, you think the pen is broken, is bending. Yeah? So you see a bending pen. But is there a bending pen outside? No. So what are you seeing now? You are seeing in reality an image in your mind, which in this case doesn't correspond to the reality. But through other ways, you can understand that you have made a mistake. You know, one of the important things in philosophy is the ability to understand that you make mistake. Because the fact that you understand you make mistake means that you can understand the truth. You know, some people always want to blame human ability for understanding by saying, you know, we make mistakes, so we cannot trust anything. Look at, you know, how much we have made mistakes in history of science. But they don't know that actually when you understand that you made a mistake, this is a success. This shows that you are able to understand that you made mistakes. So they want to use mistakes against our ability for understanding, and actually this serves to prove that we are able to understand. Okay. So, sometimes knowledge comes through mental images. And this is when you can make a sentence, or what we say, proposition. You say, this exists, this doesn't exist, this is cold, this is hot. All are ilm husuli, conceptual knowledge. But sometimes we have al-ilm al-huduri, means what you know is present. You don't need to use anything to know this. The knower has immediate understanding of what is known. Okay? For example, your understanding of yourself. Each of you senses himself or herself. Or when you are happy, or you are sad, or you are fearful, or you are hopeful, these feelings are known to you without need for any image. But as soon as you say, I am happy, this is conceptual knowledge. I am hungry, I am fearful, this is conceptual knowledge. But the feeling that you have, without being interpreted without being put into words, that is ilm huzuri. When you say I exist, this is ilm husuli. But that understanding of yourself that is always with you, that is ilm huzuri. Now, is it possible for us to have ilm huzuri of God? To know God without using anything between us and God? The answer is yes. Human beings, in the same way that they can have immediate understanding of themselves and their faculties and their feelings, they can have immediate understanding of God. This happen through fitrah, and this can be made stronger and can be cultivated through irfan. You know, you can reach the point that when you feel yourself, you feel also you are under God. If there is a ray of light coming from sun, and this ray has understanding of itself, it can have also understanding of sun and its origin. Because without sun, that cannot exist. Of course, this is an example. Otherwise, our connection to God is even closer than this. You know, hadith says, Al-mu'minu ashaddu tasalan billah min dhaw ash-shams bish-shams. The connection between mu'min and God is closer than the connection between ray of sun and sun. So, as I think I mentioned, maybe, I think it was here or maybe another place, about Du'a Arafat. Did I mention about Du'a Arafat? No. Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Mata ghibta hatta tahtaja ila dalil. When was the time that you were absent, you were hidden, so that you needed a sign that brings me to you? You know, first God has to be absent or hidden so that we need a sign. Imam Hussein says, you were never hidden from me. Is there any aqil who proves existence of himself for himself? Have you ever tried to prove that you exist? You don't need to prove that you exist. Those who have this type of understanding and this type of encounter with God, for them, God is the most obvious thing. أَيَّكُونُ لَغَيْرَكَ مِنَ الظُّهُورُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ. Is any clarity, any appearance for something other than you that you lack? Why we think, for example, these objects that we see around, they are clearer than God? This is like a person that thinks a shadow is clearer than sun. A shadow. If someone said, you know, I can see this shadow, but I cannot see sun. Okay, you have to go and fix your problems. How can a shadow be clearer than even a small light, for example, even a candle? A candle is more clearer than a shadow. Now it's middle of the day and sun is shining and you cannot see it. And then you say, because there is a shadow, there must be something that has made this shadow. So there must be a sun. So you are arguing from existence of shadow for the existence of sun. Why you don't look at sun directly? So, if you have this type of knowledge of God, you don't need to argue for God. Sometimes we don't have that level of close relation with God, but through some problems and challenges of life, all of a sudden, our eyes are opened, and then we see God. Yeah? For example, in ordinary life, I think there are many people who can help me. My father, my mother, brothers, sisters, friends, community, government, you know, there are other people, many things that can help me. My knowledge, my expertise, my money. But then when I am put into a very, very dangerous situation, and I realize that no one can ever help me. Like you are, for example, on a boat or ship, and you see that in few minutes you are going to drown. The ship is going to sink and you are going to die. You have the best captain but cannot do anything. No one can come and help you. Now, these things that were heroes for us, and we used to rely on them, all of a sudden, they all lose their significance. All the walls and barriers go away. Then you would see that a light is coming from your fitrah, from your heart. God is sending signal. I am there for you. Then you start praying to God wholeheartedly, like an Arif. You know, maybe only Urafa can say Turak a prayer with complete presence of God in their heart. But in that moment, even if you say 20 rak'ah, you have presence of heart. You can only think of God because no one else can do anything for you. فَإِذَا رَكِبُوا فِي الْفُلْكِ دَعَوُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. You know, this is the ultimate end of religion. Because Quran says, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. The ultimate end of religion is to reach this point, that you call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with purity and sincerity. You don't associate anything and anyone to God. And in this time, you achieve it. But the problem is, فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرَّ. When God saves them and they reach the sea, coast, or shore, then they forget. Only some people remember. Then again, everything appears. All people become significant. At that time, nothing was significant. So, this is also possible, that in some special times, we may also get that type of connection to God, that God for us is more present than anything else. This is something that is possible through fitra. But we want to go further. We want to see if we can use fitra as a basis for a conceptual understanding of God. What we have said so far doesn't need any argument, doesn't need any, you know, articulation. But the only thing is you have to experience it. Yes? If 100 people tell you that we see God very clearly, and God for us is closer to us than anything else, you may not accept. You may accept, if you accept, that's good, but you may not accept. You say, no, I have to experience myself. Yeah? So, therefore, we have to do two things. First is to help people that develop this experience, and this is through a spirituality. The second thing is to bring some arguments for them through philosophy or theology that they can convince themselves about existence of God till they finally reach the point that they can have that mystical understanding of God. You cannot expect everyone to start from that high level of encounter with God. And you cannot take everyone to the ocean and leave them there, you know, drowning so that they can have that understanding. So, instead of that, we say, okay, now let's see what arguments we can bring for the existence of God. So, there are different ways that scholars have tried to develop this argument as a conceptual understanding. One is to say that belief in God is fitri. What does it mean? We mentioned last week. It means that it can be found in all human beings, regardless their gender, their ethnicity, their time, their age, their geography, their religion. You find always evidence of humanity believing in God. Whether it is one God or many gods, that's another issue. Whether it's polytheism or monotheism, that's another issue. But you find in the course of history, even before history was written, in pre-history era, that humanity has always believed in some kind of deity, God. This is the first part of the argument. And the second argument is, when something is so universally accepted by all human beings, it means that it is part of our humanity to believe in this. Either you are a human or you don't believe in this. It's part of your humanity. What argument can be there for something to be acceptable to human beings better than this, that this is a fitri thing? If you can doubt your humanity, you can doubt this. Okay? Because this is something that, as we said, has all the characteristics of fitri or innate ideas. The other articulation is all human beings have yearning, desire, or love for God as the absolute perfect being, as the best being. They have this love and yearning for God. This is again proved in the same way that we proved the first part of the argument before. It has all the characteristics of fitri things. The second part is more difficult. Okay, if something is loved by all human beings and it's part of their fitra to love, why it should exist? Here, ulama have different explanations. One explanation is by Ayatollah Shahabadi, rahmatullah alayh, one of the teachers of Imam Khomeini. And this is the last point I say today. He has the idea that love cannot exist without two things: the lover and beloved. You cannot have only one. If there is only beloved and no lover, there is no love. And if there is only lover and no beloved, there is no love. Like, for example, can you have father without child. You cannot have a father or mother without child. To be parent needs to have a child. And to be a child needs to have a parent. If not both parents, like Isa alayhi salam, at least one parent. Otherwise you cannot say he's a child. Adam was not a child. Yeah? Because child means to be born to a family, to have father and mother, or at least one of them. Or folk and taht, above and under. If something is above something, means that there is something under it. You cannot have something above something without something being under it. True love, not pseudo love. Pseudo love can be just because of your imagination. You know, for example, someone tells you that there is such a place that is, you know, giving you all these, you know, for example, I don't know, benefits and all these things, and this, and then you fall in love with that place, but then he said, I told you a lie. It didn't exist. So you loved something that was just imagination. But that is not a true love. True love that you find in human beings for absolute perfection, for absolute goodness, absolute beauty, absolute kindness, that cannot be deception. That is a real love. That is a love that humanity has never been separate from. This needs a beloved. Some people have added also some examples. For example, they said in the same way that when we feel hungry, there is food. When we feel thirsty, there is a way to quench your thirst, and that is to get water. When you have this deep yearning for God, there must be God. Otherwise, this does not make sense. This is the way that Ayatollah Shah Abadi and some other people have argued. Inshallah, you can think about it, and if there is a need, we can discuss it further. Otherwise, we move on, inshallah, next session to cosmological argument. Burhanul wujub wal imkan. Please read in advance. Familiarize yourself with the concept of necessity and contingent beings, and inshallah then it makes it easier for you. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.